Good evening and welcome back to SF Commons. I'm your host, Myrna Lim. Tonight we'll be talking about the Great Reset.
A Great Reset? That sounds more like buzzword bingo masking some nefarious plan for world domination.
I see the need for a Great Reset.
This pandemic has provided an opportunity for a reset.
Once we shut down the virus and deliver economic relief to workers and businesses, then we can start to build back better than before.
But it is undoubtedly an opportunity for us to work together and build back better.
Build back better.
As the world recovers, we have a chance to reset the clock and build back better than before.
And building back better our economy and society.
We owe it to future generations to build back better and base our recovery on solid foundations.
Tonight we are fortunate to have a special guest, a very highly evolved woman. Her name is Tessa Lennon. She's an opinionated artist and a writer living in New York. She's a classically trained pianist and singer. Currently, she works in Substack, going by the name of Tessa Fights Robots. Tessa's work is about being human in the world of technology, big data, and machine-like people. Welcome, Tessa. Welcome to the show. How are you doing?
Hi, Amina. It's such a pleasure to be here with you tonight.
So, you wrote the article, Great Reset, for dummies. What is the Great Reset? What drives it?
So essentially, the Great Reset is, it's a marketing tagline. It's right. This umbrella term that is intended to mean something sweet and warm and fuzzy. And the marketing selling point is that we as a humankind, we kind of mess things up and we messed up the environment and everybody's suffering and there's this inequality and racism and all those things, which is all true, by the way. There is inequality and racism, and we have messed up the environment. But then it gets completely distorted and deceitful because from there, the very, very wealthy people of this world who somehow are using this tagline, they're saying that we should go in a particular direction to fix all that.
Now is a historical moment, a time, not only to fight severe virus, but to shape the system.
We have a unique but rapidly shrinking window of opportunity to learn lessons and reset ourselves on a more sustainable path. It is an opportunity we have never had before and may never have again. So we must use all the levers we have at our disposal, knowing that each and every one of us has a vital role to play.
The Great Reset is a welcome recognition that this human tragedy must be a wake-up call. It is imperative that we reimagine, rebuild, redesign, reinvigorate, and rebalance our world. Rebalancing investment, harnessing science and technology, and advancing the transition to net zero emissions, all elements of the Great Reset, are fundamental to building the future we need.
And that is where it's deceitful, because the measures that they're suggesting are not going to fix anything. In fact, in my humble opinion, or not so humble opinion, it's going to make things much worse.
This policy was first unveiled by the World Economic Forum and the United Kingdom's Prince Charles. And since its announcement, it has gathered support from a laundry list of economists, politicians, business people, and celebrities. But it has also gathered a fair bit of criticism. Just 72 hours after its announcement, a petition to stop it gained 80,000 signatures, which is kind of fair enough. The whole premise of this proposal does sound very ominous. Economic plans titled The Great Something have not exactly had the best track record. The fact that this plan is leveraging a disaster alongside the fact that it is pushing some pretty spicy policies means that major conspiracy theories have surfaced, ranging from this plan will make us all poorer, all the way up to this plan will make us all slaves to the lizard people.
I look at them as fellow human beings who are very broken and very scared. And the difference between them and the rest of us is that I don't think that they take the peasants seriously. I don't think they view us as fellow human beings. I think they view us as a resource, a nuisance, but definitely not their equal. So to them, we're kind of those little ants, and they look at the anthill from high above and they figure out for themselves, how do they manage this anthill? Are those ants useful to them in how we are right now at this point or not?
The whole concept of Great Reset is being sold as, you know, the world without problems.
They are now promising you will own nothing and you will be happy. What they should have added is, and we, the very rich, will own everything and be even happier. Of course they will. This Great Reset is as serious and as dangerous a threat to our prosperity, to your prosperity and your freedom, as we have faced in decades, with these powerful bodies, including the World Economic Forum.
The World Economic Forum is a non-government organisation, probably best known for their annual meetings held in Davos, Switzerland, where thousands of wealthy people descend on a small alpine village to talk about all things economics. It makes a majority of its money through membership fees, which are steep. They range anywhere from $67,000 a year to $700,000 per year, depending on the level of engagement with the organisation. So, who are these members? Well, obviously, very rich people, or influential public figures that get complimentary invites. So, by virtue of the fact that it attracts the type of people who can afford this membership, it is influential, for lack of a better way of putting it, a book club for woke billionaires, where the only thing that they discuss are economics textbooks.
The person who is smart enough I listen to is actually Russell Brand, the comedian. He makes so much sense.
In order to secure our future and to prosper, we need to evolve our economic model.
A lot of the reset idea comes from this graphic, reinvent, reimagine, which I don't know, I guess it's like a catchy little phrase. But of course there are some people out there that believe in shady global cabals running things from behind the scenes. Now, I don't believe that. I believe that there are plain, visible economic interests that dominate the direction of international policy. That's what I believe. And whether or not there is a secret shadowy cabal of hood-wearing lizard people or not is, for me, less important than the observable challenge of how to rein in the power of transnational corporations who operate beyond the control of nation states and, let's face it, who nation states see it as their primary obligation to serve, placate and pander to, rather than serving the people of the whatever nation it is that elected them.
It boils down to a totalitarian economic and political power where, you know, there's a few individuals ruling the world, and then you have the mass of people not having anything and not having any civil liberties. Because, like, for instance, right now they're trading water in Wall Street.
While you're worrying about the planet-wide COVID crisis, don't forget to worry about a possible drinking water crisis, because it was recently announced that investors can now trade water futures. Uh-oh. I don't totally understand that sentence, but it sounds like a headline in a newsreel at the beginning of Mad Max before you smash cut to one-armed Charlize Theron driving a truck full of warrior concubines through the desert. Now, here's what happened. Recently, futures tied to the California Water Index began trading on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, meaning that for the first time ever, water will be a commodity like gold or oil. Uh-oh.
Most people do not know that. They commoditize water. Whereas in California, they're dumping fresh water in the ocean.
But what are they doing with that water? They're flushing this year 75% of it to the ocean. Of the total water coming out of the Delta, 75% is going to the ocean. That is a problem. It's a political problem.
Well, the Great Reset to me, it sounds like there's no independent sovereignties. It's just like one globe, one world, and there are these people who are going to rule the world. The people who have the economic power will have total political power. Like Jeff Bezos, he's raking $1 trillion. In 2018, Amazon paid zero in taxes.
Amazon is a very sophisticated taxpayer.
Amazon is very much the canary in the coal mine.
They're really doing what a lot of politicians wish more companies would do.
Amazon is a huge company. But do you know just how huge it really is?
We start with amazing Amazon. Somewhere CEO Jeff Bezos is smiling.
It's one of only two U.S. companies to ever reach a $1 trillion valuation.
No one in history has become as rich as quickly.
It's made Jeff Bezos the richest man in the world.
That is 100 million Prime subscribers globally.
And if you put those Prime subscribers in one country, it would be the 14th largest on the planet. The planet. But that massive company paid no federal income tax on more than $11 billion in profits in 2018. And somehow, they actually got a $129 million tax rebate.
I paid more taxes than him. The janitor in our building paid more taxes than him. And he got $129 million in rebate. I was watching one interview with Elon Musk, right? Who somehow or other, his wealth increased by 600%, right? He was talking about how they already have an experiment now where they inject a chip in a monkey's brain that teaches monkey how to do play chess or something.
As you can see, Pager is amazingly good at mind pump.
In 2020, it was a pig with a chip in its brain. In 2021, it's a monkey playing video games. Elon Musk's Neuralink has just unveiled its latest brain-computer interface, showing a 9-year-old monkey named Pager controlling a game of Pong with its mind, all thanks to a Neuralink chip implanted in each side of its brain. The demo starts simple enough. The monkey plays a simple game on screen using a joystick. If he moves the joystick the right way, he gets a banana smoothie. But all the while, the game is using the chip inside the monkey's brain to train a computer to understand his movements. The Neuralink chips are surgically implanted inside Page's skull. They connect to his brain via more than 2,000 electrodes, each one about 1/20th the width of a human hair, and implanted in the regions of his brain that control hand and arm movement.
Well, why don't we inject a human chip in your brain, Elon Musk? It's crazy and it's scary because, as a matter of fact, on one of the better interviews he had, he said artificial intelligence is here.
There's no denying robots and automation are increasingly part of our daily lives. Just look around the grocery store or the highway, or in the case of robothespian here, even at the theater.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain.
The rise of robots has led to some pretty scary warnings about the future of work.
Robots will be able to do everything better than us.
A recent study found up to 670,000 US jobs were lost to robots between 1990 and 2007, and that number is likely to go up. A widely cited study from 2013 found nearly half of all jobs in the US are in danger of being automated over the next 20 years. Occupations that require repetitive and predictable tasks in transportation, logistics, and administrative support were especially high risk. And just think, robots don't need health benefits, vacation, or even sleep for that matter.
You see those robots doing perfect machinations, doing gymnastics and all that. There's a move to get rid of people's jobs. You go to self-service centers.
I agree with you. And I think that this pandemic has been used to essentially take out the small businesses out of the market. Because again, remember the idea is that the idea is super extra monopoly.
So yeah. For one year, they have closed the restaurants.
COVID crisis has impacted so many industries this year as the virus forced businesses across the country to close their doors. Mom and pop shops, as you know, were especially hard hit and are struggling to stay afloat amidst the pandemic.
And then you obliterate those, you stop churches from having their congregations, you dictate how many people can go to somebody's home to celebrate Thanksgiving, and you dictate how many people that you can have the restaurants, and then you have to have DoorDash. Suddenly they're billionaires. You have Uber, Lyft. Suddenly they're billionaires. Wiped out restaurants. But then you've got Target, you've got Safeway, and those are the only things that are open anyway that people can go to. No gyms, nothing.
These mandates and these oppressive policies turn you, our heroes, into zeros. You can't keep your jobs, you won't be able to go into a gym or a ball game or a theater or a restaurant. This is blatant, irrational discrimination, and it's unjust, unethical, and it cannot stand.
There is this obliteration of civil liberties. People would die to be deprived of their civil liberties because that triggers your freedom of assembly, freedom of speech, freedom of religion. All those freedoms are suddenly out. People would actually die for those things. But then under this so-called pandemic, under fear, people have learned or are forced to accept that.
Brought you out here today.
I'm fighting for my freedom.
I see you brought some signs. Can you tell us a little bit about the signs?
Well, I'm definitely against passports or mandates. I'm a nurse, and the number one thing that is taught is respect for autonomy, and we're not even giving our own rights.
I'm a firefighter. We're dealing with that right now. Our unions are actually at the table talking about it's our right. You can't force this on it, so there's a lot of that going on right now with attorneys. It's just not right.
The medical workers are now losing their jobs because of their choice. It's a system of oppression that is just going to continue moving forward if people don't stand up and stand against it.
If it came down to you getting the vaccine or getting fired, which would you choose?
I'll take fired.
I'm going to let them fire me, and I will seek legal help.
I will not stick a needle in my body if I'm told to do so. So the choice will be between my attorney and legal options. What do we have to do?
What do you think about all this?
Well, I think there's an attack of humanity. I think that the loss of human, the attack on human contact, yeah. I mean, I'm mad about that because, and I think it's deliberate because when people are united, then essentially nobody can get us because having a strong community is extremely important. And I think that there's a lot of artificial hostility created around the things that really are, like, they're not intrinsically conflict generated. Like, for example, like everybody's saying, everybody I respect, they respect everybody regardless of their gender identity and whatever it is. I mean, like, it just goes automatically. Like, there's another human being, right. You treat them with absolute respect. And I've been noticing it's very much an American thing, actually, because even years ago when I came to the States, I found out about hot buttons, about the issues that I never even thought, like people even argued about, you know, which way to put toilet seat, like leave it up or leave it down. People would argue like in a heated manner.
You guys are so concerned about the environment. Why don't you wipe your own assholes with your hands?
Take responsibility for yourself.
Look, this is not about Jordan being a disgusting guy who can't stop shitting. This is about how you put the toilet paper on the roll. It goes over the top.
And that was kind of like a cute issue, but I've never heard about it as an issue until I came to the States. So I think people, political marketers have figured out, I mean, that's my theory about it,
right.
You can take the feeling of indignity that is genuine in our society. I mean, just the way it's been structured, authentic respect is very rare because we've been having like rat race and we're working to just make some money to impress others with whatever we make. That's not dignified living, essentially, right? So that feeling of a suppressed indignity and sort of resentment, it's been used by political marketers to divide and conquer.
So how can people oppose this great reset? The great reset is not for the masses. It's not for you. It's not for me. It's not for our families. It's not for the next generation. It's for these few uber wealthy individuals who already control the economy and the politics, and now they just want to merely consolidate their money and power over all of the masses.
I think that the answers are more philosophical and existential than political per se, because politically it's very hard to do anything with those people. They have everybody bribed. You know, in America, like this party, that party, doesn't matter. I mean, like they have everybody under control, essentially, I think. That is my belief anyway. And this way or the other, if somebody comes up with a good idea, then they immediately find a way to use this very good idea and to use it against the people and to enrich themselves. So I don't have much hope for politics except for maybe local politics, but I think that if we massively refuse to be abused, just as human beings, if we just refuse to betray our neighbors, if we just don't accept the fact that it's okay to separate us from nature, that it's okay to separate us from each other, and I think it's an act of courage.
It's time for us to resist. They can't arrest all of us. They can't keep all of your kids home from school. They can't keep every government building closed, although I've got a long list of ones they might keep closed or might ought to keep closed. We don't have to accept the mandates, lockdowns, and harmful policies of the petty tyrants and bureaucrats. We can simply say no, not again. Nancy Pelosi, you will not arrest or stop me or anyone on my staff from doing our jobs. We have either had COVID, had the vaccine, or been offered the vaccine. We will make our own health choices. We will not show you a passport. We will not wear a mask. We will not be forced into random screenings and testings so you can continue your drunk with power reign over the Capitol. President Biden, we will not accept your agency's mandates or your reported moves towards a lockdown. No one should follow the CDC's anti-science mask mandates. And if you want to shut down federal agencies again, some of which aren't even back to work yet, I will stop every bill coming through the Senate with an amendment to cut their funding if they don't come back to work in person.
I say that this generation, well, that perhaps our generation, but anyway, this generation being born now, very shortly in most countries, and it's already happened in say, China, most European countries, the United States, is the last free generation. You're born, and either immediately or within, say, a year, you're known globally. Your identity in one form or another, as a result of your idiotic parents plastering your name and photos over Facebook, or as a result of insurance applications or passport applications, transport on airlines, etc. You are known to all the world's major powers, all the world's major state powers, and all the world's major commercial powers. That's a very different situation for individuals to be in than they have previously been in. That's a cultural change for humanity.
I'm here at the anti-vaccine mandates vaccine passport rally in San Francisco. And everyone has come here because we're tired of the medical tyranny.
No cards.
No tyranny. Otherwise, take the Statue of Liberty back to France.